Favorite song. Scream and say, every praise is to our God. Every word of worship. I need somebody to run out to this front right now. Let's just have a big celebration, a big party. Get out of your seat and come on. Come on down here. Run down here. Run down here. Run, 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 run. Come on. Come on. Come on.
Welcome, everybody, to our first Wednesday of every month worship service. So thank you all for joining, and looks like we have 24 participants, which is wonderful. We are going to open up our worship service with a call to worship, and I will open us up in prayer. Let's bow our heads and bring our heart and our minds to the Lord. God, we love you. We honor you today as we worship you here in Volunteers America, Chesapeake and Carolinas. Lord, as a ministry of service and a church without walls, we just are grateful to you for enabling us to serve you, serve others, love others, be compassionate to others. Lord, thank you for blessing our church without walls with incredible ministry, incredible people of service. And Lord, we're just thankful for the opportunity to spend time with you today. We honor you, we give you glory, and invite you into our gathering today virtually, invite you into our hearts, invite you into everything we do. We love you. You're a loving God, and we love you so much, and we just honor you. In your name we pray. Amen.
There is a bug in Gilead. There is a bug in Gilead. Praise the Lord, church. Today's scripture will be read from Luke 4, 18 through 19, King James Version. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captive, and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. Thank you for the reading of his word.
Karen, I'm on. Hang on, y'all. I apologize for delay. It's my pleasure and honor to introduce our own David Griever as the speaker for today. And I was trying to really put into words what David means to me and to all of us. He's first and foremost a brother in Christ. And I was kind of scrolling through there and I thought I'd just share with you, if you read the Bible and particularly in Corinthians, and you learn about the 12 fruits of the Holy Spirit, David, I think, emulates most of them, if not all of them. Joyful, peaceful, patient, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faith, modesty, self-control. Those are ones that I'm just reading in front of me currently, but that really does tell you a lot about this man of God and his commitment to the Lord as well as to the kingdom. We're grateful to have him here today to talk about and give us a little word of revival of God's mission. So David, thank you for all that you are and all that you do.
Give me praise the Lord, everyone. If you could give me a praise the Lord so I know you can hear me.
Praise the Lord.
Greetings in the lovely, precious name of Jesus. Thank you, Reverend Gray. I am honored and counted a privilege to minister to this body today. Reverend Gray texted me on January the 8th and asked me if I could minister this service. I quickly said yes, not knowing what I wanted to speak about. At the time, I was traveling and helping a pastor in Columbus, Ohio, and the next Sunday morning in prayer, waiting for service to begin, a word, a message came to me. My message to you today is don't lose sight of the mission that was his and he entrusted to his church. Approximately 2,000 years ago, Jesus entered the world in the land of Israel, a land occupied by the Roman Empire and ruled by the Herodian dynasty, a land of oppression, violence, and injustice. An essential part of Jesus' mission was to die for our sins on the cross, and through repentance and faith in him, open the way for us to experience eternal life. When the angel announced his birth, the angel said, "And thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins." Early in Jesus' ministry, he stood up in the synagogue in Nazareth and read from the writings of Isaiah, Luke 4, 18 through 19. "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord." The Jewish people of Jesus' day had a passionate desire for freedom from the domination of the pagan Romans and the oppressive Herodian dynasty that had ruled them for many years. Revolt seethed continuously, mostly underground, for more than 100 years from the time Herod became king in 37 BC until the Romans destroyed Jerusalem and the temple in 70 AD. It is helpful to realize that this underlying struggle is the backdrop of Jesus' ministry and why so many hoped he would be a conquering king. But that was not his mission. In John 6:15, after he fed the multitude with 5 loaves and 2 fish, we read where Jesus withdrew when he perceived the people so desirous of deliverance, intended to come and make him king by force. But his mission was not to be an earthly king. Even after spending 3 years with him, listening to him teach and preach, his apostles still did not understand. In Acts 1 and 6, it says, "And then they gathered around him and asked, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" But that was not his mission. The Jewish people's mission was earthly and temporal, but Jesus' mission was spiritual and eternal. The people wanted an earthly kingdom, but Jesus came to establish a church leading to a heavenly kingdom. The people wanted a king to deliver them from Roman occupation and a Herodian rule, to take vengeance upon them responsible for oppression, violence, and injustice. But Jesus came to deliver people from their sin. Jesus told Peter in the Garden of Gethsemane when he was being arrested. He said, "Put your sword back in its place, for all who draw the sword will die by the sword." Jesus did not try to solve the political issues of the day. Jesus did not try to solve the oppression and injustice wrought by the Herodian dynasty and the Romans on the Jewish people. He did not come to end Roman occupation. He did not come to end Herodian oppression. He did not come to solve corruption and bring justice. That was not his mission. His mission was the reconciliation of man to God through his sacrifice on the cross, and to minister to the needs of all people, regardless of their race, regardless of their past, regardless of who they were. No one was excluded. The lame could walk, the dumb could talk, the blind could see, the deaf could hear, and the dead lived again. Peter, preaching to Cornelius in his house in Acts 10, he said, "You know what has happened throughout the province of Judea, beginning in Galilee, after the baptism that John preached, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power, and how he went around doing good and healing all who were under the power of the devil, because God was with him. He fed the hungry, he healed the sick, he forgave sins, he opened the doors of heaven to a thief, a rebel on the cross. And when Jesus ascended to heaven, he left behind a people, a church to be his feet, his hands, and his voice. A church built upon the revelation that he was the Christ, the Son of the living God, and a promise that the gates of hell would not prevail against the church. We take on the label of Christian, which by definition is one who professes belief in the teachings of Jesus Christ. So should not his mission be our mission? Should not his charge be our commission? Before he ascended into heaven, he said to the disciples, "Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you." And in Acts 1:8, it says, "But." Now, when you see "but," you need to look at what was before. And when you look at what was before, it is that scripture that I had already brought to your attention in Acts 1:6, when his disciples came to him and they said, "Is this the time now that you will restore the kingdom to Israel?" And his response to that was that it is not for you to know the times or the dates the Father has set by his own authority. See, the disciples were talking about an earthly and temporal kingdom, but Jesus' answers refer to a heavenly and eternal kingdom. And so he says in response to their question, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." But that's not all. In Jesus' Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 6, he taught us how to give to those in need. In Matthew 25, Jesus describes how the Son of Man will separate the people from all nations. And he said, "For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me." And then they will ask, "When did we see all this? When did we do all this? We didn't see this." And the king will reply, "Truly, I tell you, whatever you did for the least of these, you've done it unto me." Now, these next statements may be controversial, but I do not believe that God called us to be social justice warriors. He called us to be soul winners. God did not call us to be activists. He called us to be witnesses. He did not call us to be Democrat or Republican, liberal or conservative, to ascribe to a left or a right ideology. He called us to be apostles and prophets and evangelists and pastors and teachers. He did not call us to fight an earthly system of injustice. He called us to a spiritual warfare. In Ephesians, we read, "For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places." We must not lose sight of the mission. Please understand that I am not saying that we cannot have a cause, but the problem comes when that cause corrupts the mission. When that cause becomes a weight that hinders the race that we are running. Paul told us to strip off every weight that slows us down. When we can no longer look at the offenders of our earthly and temporal cause and see a soul that deserves our love and the love of God, we have a problem. We have heard Black Lives Matter, Blue Lives Matter, All Lives Matter. I submit to you today this statement that every soul matters. A soul is priceless. What good will it do be for someone to gain the whole world and yet forfeit their soul? Jesus said, joy shall be in heaven over one sinner that repenteth more than over 99 just persons which need no repentance. I ask you, what do you see? Is your cause to end child molestation? Can you look at the child molester and see a soul? Could you minister to them and share the gospel without contempt and hate in your heart? Is your cause social justice? Can you look at the white supremacist and see a soul? Can you minister to them and share the gospel without contempt and hate in your heart? If you confront the murderer who killed your loved one, can you see a soul? Could you minister them and share the gospel without contempt and hate in your heart? The flesh, human nature, wants retribution and a revenge. But Jesus taught us in Matthew 5, do not resist evil. Do not resist evil. But whosoever shall smite thee on the right cheek, turn to him the other also. And if any man sue thee at the law and take away thy coat, let him have thy cloak also. And whosoever shall compel thee to go a mile, go with him twain. The flesh, human nature, is to hate your enemy. But Jesus taught us in Matthew 5, love your enemies. Bless them that curse you. Do good to them that hate you. Pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you, that ye may be children of your Father, which is in heaven. Do not let the cause corrupt the mission. I am addressing this today because of what I am witnessing. I am seeing hate and contempt justified for the sake of an earthly and temporal cause. My right conservative Christian friends, they loved it when Trump was elected. Oh, they said, everything's going to be good now. Everything's going to be great. We're saved. Things are just going to get better. And so there was this period of economic growth that was just historical. And we look at that, and then we see a man who gets up and says, see what I did. See what I did. Look at what I have accomplished. And it was all reversed. 3 years of progress in economics reversed in 3 months because of a microscopic virus. And so now my right conservative Christian friends, they're upset that Biden is in office. And they're talking to me with hate and contempt. And they're telling me that they're ready for revolution. They're ready to fight. And I ask them, I say, are you willing to kill a soul for the sake of a temporal and earthly ideology? My left liberal Christian friends, I have friends on both sides. And when Trump was elected, I heard hate and contempt from them for Trump. I heard about all the things that they didn't like about him and how the man should just go away. And then when Biden was elected, they said, yay, we're saved, we're saved. This is gonna be so good. I am reminded of Habakkuk, who cried out to the Lord. He said, oh Lord, how long must I call for help, but you do not listen? Or cry out violence, but you do not save? Why do you make me look at injustice? Why do you tolerate wrongdoing? Destruction and violence are before me. There is strife and conflict abounds. Therefore, the law is paralyzed and justice never prevails. The wicked hem in the righteous so that justice is perverted. Sounds familiar, doesn't it? And God's answer says, I am, but it's not what you expect. Habakkuk had a second complaint and God answers again. And in that answer is this statement. The just shall live by their faith. It was a statement that Paul repeated three more times in his writings. I am here today to assure you that God's power is not diminished by who sits in the White House. God's sovereignty is not diminished by public policy. God is the master conductor, bringing events to pass that will lead to his soon return. I'm here to tell you today, do not lose faith. Do not lose sight of the mission. Proverbs 4:23 tells us, above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it. What you feed your soul will affect you. If you feed it hateful rhetoric, hate will grow in your heart. If you feed it bigotry and racism and prejudice, then bigotry and racism and prejudice will be in your heart. If you feed it violence, retribution, and vengeance, then violence, retribution, and vengeance will be in your heart. Jesus is coming back for a church, a people that are holy, for without holiness, no man shall see the Lord. There will be no hate in heaven. There will be no contempt in heaven. There will be no prejudice in heaven, or bigotry, or racism, or violence, or retribution, or vengeance. I close with this. One of the comments that concern me that I heard, out of many that I've heard, is that there can be no forgiveness without repentance. That is not true. If we're going to receive forgiveness from God, then we must forgive. Matthew 6:15, but if you do not forgive others their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. Are we saying that we're willing to risk eternal damnation because you're waiting for someone to say, I'm sorry? Jesus was led to Golgotha, to Calvary, along with two thieves. Some translations call them criminals, some translations call them rebels. Some people think that there was an angry thief and a contrite thief. But if you study your scripture, you'll read in Matthew 27 that two rebels were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. And those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, you who are going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself, come down from the cross. If you are the Son of God, in the same way the chief priests and teachers of the law and the elders mocked him, he saved others, they said, but he can't save himself. He's the King of Israel. Let him come down now from the cross, and we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God rescue him now if he wants him. For he said, I am the Son of God. And notice what is said in verse 44. In the same way, the rebels, plural, the thieves, who were crucified with him also heaped insults on him. What was it that changed the heart of one thief? Perhaps it was something he saw as he watched a man who had been brutalized, his flesh hanging in shreds from a scourging, bruises from being punched in the face and beaten, blood streaming from his head, where a crown of thorns was placed. He watched as this man looked down on the people that called for his crucifixion, the people who brutalized his body. And he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. God demonstrated forgiveness without repentance. And could it have been that this thief, this rebel, this criminal just witnessed unfathomable love and compassion, and his hard, stony heart cracked? And perhaps he thought, if he can forgive them, maybe he can forgive me too. And the other thief cried out, aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us. But the other criminal rebuked him. Don't you fear God, he said, since you're under the same sentence. We are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong. And then he said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus answered, truly, I tell you today, you will be with me in paradise. To summarize, the mission comes down to two things that Jesus revealed in three commandments: love God and love people. And if you truly want to make a difference in this world, to be a true Christian and be an imitation of Christ, as Paul instructed in his letter to the church in Ephesus, he told them, follow God's example, therefore, as dearly beloved children, and walk in the way of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice of God. My message today to you is, do not lose sight of the mission. In Jesus' name, thank you. Hallelujah.
Let us take this time together, and I've got an echo. Thank you, Reverend Griever, for that powerful message. And this is our time in front of the altar, and in our imaginary altar, our altar in front of us right now, wherever you may be. And let us spend our time in meditation. Let us spend the next 30 seconds to a minute in silent meditation, reflecting on what Reverend Griever preached to us, praying for our country, praying for every man, woman, and child and family that we know is hurting, that is having struggles with COVID-19, that is struggling with their relationships, struggling with their everyday life due to the separation in this pandemic. Lord, let us just spend the time reflecting on those that we love and care about. And as Reverend Griever said, let us just lift up those that we love, those that we care love, whether stranger, whether friend, whether family, whomever it may be. Let us pray for change in this world. Service today, let's remember the words and the message that Reverend Griever blessed us with today. And may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. And may the Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen.